northern Norway to the toe of Italy, thoughtful Europeans have seen in this astonishing success a pointer to the future welfare of their continent. In countless discussions, the same questions are being asked. Is it reasonable, when everywhere around us there is evidence of the progress that our united effort can achieve, is it reasonable to revive our differences, to set up our frontiers and our barriers again? Is it logical, when so much of the world is finding unity of aim and action, is it logical for Europe to remain disunited? Is it sane, when confronted with such a show of strength, not to combine our strength in precaution? From such self-questionings, there has emerged a powerful and spontaneous movement, urging a new vision of the future, demanding a united Europe.
Europe can only be united by the heartfelt wish and vehement expression of the great majority of all the peoples, in all the parties, in all the freedom-loving countries, no matter where they dwell or how they vote. We cannot aim at anything less than the union of Europe as a whole, and we look forward with confidence to the day when that union will be achieved.
The union of Europe. First a hope, and then a solemn promise, signed and sealed in London as the purpose of governments and peoples alike. What does it mean to you and me, the unity of Europe? Just another formula to cover the same old conflict in our minds? Or can we make it something close and real and vital? Look for a moment at the things that we've left undone. We speak of the splendor of our European legacy. Are we to hand on this legacy as well? Or can the unity of Europe help to sweep these things away? Basic to all attempts to raise our living standards are our coal and steel. It stands to reason that sooner or later, we must jointly plan and jointly share the output of our European mines and furnaces. Under the Schuman plan, some European nations have already pledged themselves to do just this. A simple act of faith. But it may mean much to those who still lack a hearth, a home, a steady job. And then the myriad products of our factories and farms. How can we live fully if we cannot buy them from our neighbor countries that produce them? Yet since the war, problems of exchange and currency have hobbled Europe's commerce, hindered the flow of international trade. Here again is a barrier that greater unity can help to break. European Payments Plan. Another act of faith. By easing the finance of trade between our peoples, it has set goods moving once more across the frontiers. And that again means much to many Europeans. Not only to makers and growers, but to everyone who shops around for something a little different. Something a little new. Then the crucial question of our own defense. At what a cost have we learnt that allies cannot afford to be antagonists? At what a cost have we found out that independence in peace can lead to helpless impotence in the moment of assault. In the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, we have made still another act of faith, made a start towards pooling our men and materials and resources for the common security of the Western world. And as we in Europe show in growing strength our confidence to resist attack, so we may expect the nations of North America to join with us in all their might. Here, in General Eisenhower's words, is the pledge of their support.
As the gigantic production machines of the civilized world have gotten into the swing of deliveries, munitions are beginning to flow, and there will be a rapid increase in the speed with which units are produced upon the fields of Western Europe.
At last we have realized that the only guarantee of safety that we have lies in the united forces of our united people. And now it is for the Council of Europe, backed by Europeans everywhere, to secure the benefits of unity in other fields as well. The land of the setting sun. The world beyond the West. Charming enough they were, our little separate histories. But we cannot live in history now. We cannot, we dare not live on as we did before. Let us meet the greater needs of our present and our future, open-minded, single-minded, one in thought and action. Let the barriers vanish, for today we need every ounce of strength that our united effort can put forth. Look at us, Europeans, 200 million men and women, able, versatile, intelligent. Look at our power to produce. Without the barriers between us, it could fulfill far more of our peacetime needs. Combined with that of friends across the ocean, it could be overwhelming should war be thrust upon us. Look at the markets we could create among and for ourselves. If our trade knew no barriers, if our goods knew no restriction, living would be better for us all. Brighter, cheaper, fuller. Look at what our engineers, technicians, organizers have been able to achieve, even working behind their separate frontiers. Think of the marvels they could create if they were working together. With all this at our command, what need is there for Europe to be the land of the setting sun? Look to our orchards, our pastures, and our fields. The whole wide world is running short of food. But think of the ingenuity of our more enterprising farmers, of their deep knowledge of how to coax more from the land. If this will to increase were freely imparted across the frontiers, how greatly we could add to our ability to feed ourselves. The barriers vanish. For all that we possess of energy and skill can only yield its full reward if we be united in aim, in mind, in heart, in action. Let those who follow say of us that in the hour of choice we chose the course of duty to each other. That through the unity of Europe we brought the round world closer to the unity of all mankind.